Parliament is back in session, but for many New Zealanders, those glamorous halls of power are a bit out of touch with the problems they're still facing. The cost of living continues to rise. The Reserve Bank isn't hinting the OCR is about to go down anytime soon, and groceries on the supermarket shelves, well, they're not really any cheaper. On the face of it, it all sounds very doom and gloom, but someone who's promised to turn around those pressures is Prime Minister Christopher Luxon, who joins us this morning. Good morning, Mr. Luxon. We've had a good summer. But everyone's back at work in the daily grind, and I'm curious to know, what can you point to as a specific act the government has done or has underway that will tackle the cost of living?
Well, Happy New Year, and I hope you had a good break too. But look, we're right into it, and you know, even before Christmas, there were three things that we've started to action immediately. The first is that we've got our Reserve Bank focused 100% on fighting inflation. We've passed laws in Parliament to keep them focused on that. Why? Because exactly as you identified, Kiwis are doing it so, so tough at the moment, and we've got to get inflation down so we can get interest rates down so we can grow the economy. And so we're single-mindedly focused on lowering inflation. So one, we've got the Reserve Bank Act that's been changed so that they're 100% focused on fighting inflation. Secondly, we're going through public sector savings at the moment, making sure that every taxpayer dollar that the taxpayer pays the government is actually used in the most efficient way possible. Why are we doing that? Because actually that government spending has been leading to domestic inflation, which is the major cause of our inflation problems. And the third thing that we're doing is we're getting rid of red tape, because we actually want to lower the costs so that actually those costs aren't passed on from businesses into higher prices. So, you know, there's three things that we did in our first 2 weeks before we closed for Christmas, and we're going to continue to drive into making sure we can lower inflation. Good to see some improvements. You would have seen last week that inflation came down to, I think, 4.7%. That's still a long way away from our target of being under 3%, and that's what we've got to keep driving towards.
Yeah, because domestic inflation is still at 5.9. Rental prices are still up. Household utilities are still up. Any decrease in food pricing is being attributed largely to seasonal summer produce. The things you have pointed to, they're long-term, aren't they, really? The tail takes a while to kick in before people actually walking down the grocery aisle or filling up at the pump manage to see an impact on their weekly bill.
But we are very focused as a government. You know, our number one job, as we talked about over the last year, is we have to lower inflation, we have to improve the cost of living for New Zealanders. We're focused on that job, we're talking about that. Our 100-day plan has been very focused on making sure we can deliver that. When we come out of our 100-day plan on March the 8th, we're going to have quarterly activity plans to make sure that we've got actions that are happening to lower the cost of living for people. But you're right, we have to undo an ungodly mess that has been left behind in terms of actually the state of our books are not great. We've got to keep driving inflation down so we can lower those interest rates, get the economy growing again.
And so maybe if we don't see the result of that in the first 100 days, when do you peg that we will see it? When will we see the impact of these actions?
Well, it's a combination of making sure we make a series of actions and stay 100% focused that everything we're doing is designed to lower the cost of living for Kiwis. You're starting to see us be very focused on that. We've only been in government essentially for 2 months. We've already taken a series of actions before Christmas. We're going to continue to drive and take actions each and every week. You would have seen today, for example, we're actually disbanding the Productivity Commission so we can create a Ministry of Regulation designed to go after that red tape challenge that every sector is experiencing. There are rules and red tape and guidelines from government and regulations that actually don't add any value. They just add costs to farmers or to small businesses that end up reflecting on higher prices. So, you know, that's how we actually solve these problems so that actually we deal with them properly and get to the root cause of what's actually causing our problems for New Zealanders.
Okay, the other big issue that Kiwis were concerned about pre-election was crime. How come there isn't a single policy in your 100-day plan to address crime?
Well, watch this space. The 100 days is up on March the 8th, but that is very much our focus on the time between now and then. Our ministers have been working incredibly hard with officials to bring forward legislation that will actually enact the policies that we've talked about in our 49 actions and our 100-day plan to start the progress on crime. And so rest assured, watch this space. That's something no doubt that we'll be talking about in the coming weeks.
But you were the party that was really tough on crime. It was a massive issue pre-election. So how come it's not a bigger focus in the first 100 days?
Well, it is, Anna. What I'd say to you is go read the 49 actions and the 100-day plan, including our plans to get going with the gang patches, to be tougher on gangs, to give the police the powers they need. All of that work is underway in government. That's what we've been working with officials from day one. And watch the space. We'll actually be bringing that legislation into Parliament to make sure we can give the police those powers to start to tackle that crime and to get it under control.
And I have read your plan, and gangs are a part of it, but there is no mention of retail crime. The word retail doesn't even feature in it. There's nothing about ram raids. The word crime doesn't even feature in the 100-day plan that I could find in a search of the document. And when we've seen in the last month, there have been jewellery store smash and grabs, the 27th, ram raided a sports store on the 4th, ram raided a petrol station on the 21st, violent assault at a dairy on the 8th. We are not even a month into the new year.
Yeah, Mel, these are problems that we're inherited, and I agree with that, but don't misunderstand me. Our 100-day plan does have actions to restore law and order and to deal with crime in this country. That is what Mark Mitchell and the Justice team are working incredibly hard around. Rest assured, we're talking about actioning the things that we talked about before the election, and they're going to bring that legislation into the House very, very shortly.
Speaking of Mark Mitchell, he came up in the news yesterday because it turns out that he may have already broken your first coalition promise that you won't be able to deliver 500 new police in 2 years. It'll now be three. How did you get that wrong?
Oh, look, he may have muddled his words a little bit, but our coalition agreement stands, which is that we want to deliver 500 new police within the two-year period, and that's what we're very focused on. But what Mark's talking to is the difficulty around that in terms of actually recruitment challenges that we have, retiring police force, and certainly an Australian campaign that's been pretty successful with our police officers as well. But we're not backing down on that. We want to go for that goal. We know it's tough, we know it's challenging, but between us and police, we're going to be committed to delivering that.
Just wind back a little bit. What do you mean he muddled his words? When and where did he muddle his words?
Well, what I mean is, you said he broke a coalition agreement commitment. He hasn't. Our coalition agreement commitment to deliver 500 police in 2 years stands. We're acknowledging the challenges, and that's what he was talking to, was actually some of the challenges that we're encountering as he now has taken over the responsibility of police minister. What he's encountered is actually the challenges around recruitment are more difficult, but that's not a reason for us to change the target. We're going to be very committed to going after 500 new police in a two-year period because that's important in order to be able to restore law and order.
Have you and Mark had a conversation around this? Because he seemed quite clear about backing up his reasons yesterday about why it was going to take 3 years and not two.
Look, I mean, we're really clear. Our goal remains very clearly 2 years, 500 police officers. We know there are real challenges. Let's be clear, the Australians have come into New Zealand and made big campaigns to try and recruit New Zealand police officers to come to Australia. We know that we actually have an ageing profile of police officers that will retire in the coming years. And we know it's been difficult under the previous government to actually finding recruits to want to come and join the police. We're going to work on all of those things to make sure that we can deliver on that commitment.
OK, can I be really clear on this, just because you have emphasised that you are going to stick to this two-year commitment, but our producers and Jenny May have just told us they have also had conversations with Mark Mitchell that have been on this program on air, where he has said they've had to, quote, expand the recruitment from 2 years to three because of recruitment and retention issues. So when did it go from 3 years, like you said yesterday and like you said previously, back to the two that you are now telling me this morning? Have you two had a conversation since those comments yesterday where you have emphasised he has to do it in two?
Well, Mark and I talk quite regularly, but we're very clear that we're actually committed to the two-year goal for 500 police officers. He didn't express that well at times, but he understands that that's our commitment that we've got. We're determined to deliver on that. We know it's challenging. Let's be clear, it's very difficult, but it's not a goal that we're prepared to change. We want to have that ambition and some aspiration to make sure that we can recruit as many police officers as possible. And our coalition agreement with New Zealand First stands, which is that we want to be able to deliver 500 police officers in 2 years.
So on Monday he said 3 years, on Tuesday he said 3 years, on Wednesday you say 2 years. Is Mark Mitchell today going to say 2 years or 3 years?
It's 2 years, let's be clear about it. Mark understands that, I understand that, everyone understands that, the police understand that. That's our goal, that's what we're striving for. What Mark has talked about is the difficulties in delivering against that. We know it's difficult, we know it's challenging, but we're a government with some ambition and aspiration, and we're actually going to do everything we can to deal with that despite the factors that are against us.
OK, let's move on to Waitangi. Coming up next week, there were some fairly heated speeches in your direction at Ratana. What are you expecting next week?
Oh, look, well, every Waitangi Day, go back through the history over multiple decades, can be quite intense, no doubt about it. But actually, it's a good day. I enjoy going there. I like going there. I'm looking forward to it. There'll be no doubt stimulation, provocation, challenge on both sides of it, in terms of the conversations that take place in and around Waitangi. But, I look forward to it. I think we're going to be in for a good Waitangi Day. And, I think the big conversations for us are to think about where are we going as a country for 2040, 200 years on from the signing of the treaty. And so So, you know, that's a good conversation that we've been having with iwi leaders up and down the country over the last year about how can they work with our government to deliver improved outcomes for Māori. And a lot of that conversation will continue up there as well.
It's going to be about the treaty principles bill, though, isn't it? Because Māori and non-Māori are telling you they don't want a debate over treaty principles. Your own description has been in the past that it's divisive and unhelpful. So do you think the way that all of this is playing out is a good look for your government?
Well, look, I mean, as we said from the beginning, you know, we've got a treaty principles bill. The coalition agreement is that we will support that through to first reading, but we're not, you know, beyond that, there's no intention, no commitment, no support to take it further than that. There'll be an aeration of those issues. But I just say to you, in my conversation with iwi leaders, they're concerned about the things that we are as well. Why are two-thirds of our Māori kids not in school this week, over the last year? You know, why is it, you know, it's 55% of our Kiwi kids aren't in school at the moment regularly across this country? Those are the concerns that actually iwi leaders and government want to work together on. We believe delivering those outcomes, actually partnering with iwi organisations to do that, is a critical part of our way forward to get a step change in the results that we've seen.
I don't want to imply that you are not listening or have misinterpreted, but the message very strongly seems to be they want to talk about the treaty principles bill that's coming through. And I know that your message at Ratana was the government has no plans and has never had plans to amend or revise the treaty. Those are your words, and the government will honour it. But are you saying one thing and doing another by, at the very least, at the bare minimum, supporting this bill to its first reading?
No, I mean, I've been meeting with iwi leaders regularly, Anna, for the last year. We have lots of conversations behind closed doors. We've had very constructive conversations with iwi leaders even across the last, you know, 3-4 months, and those continue to happen. There is a real focus about how do we improve Māori outcomes. That exists across the whole of our government. We are here to do that job. When you look at Māori outcomes economically, health, housing, education, victims of crime, you know, those same concerns that we are as a government going to be focused on improving for all New Zealanders, Māori also are concerned about that. We know that we want to be able to work with iwi organisations in particular to deliver those services at times to improve those outcomes. A good example is what we signed up to before Christmas. We're spending $50 million up and down the country to make sure that we can improve immunisation rates for under 2-year-olds. We know that there's a real challenge, particularly in the Māori community, so we've got good partnerships in place to deliver that. That's the kind of thing we want to work together a lot more on. So, you know, I get it. Yep, there'll be a discussion around the treaty principles bill, no doubt about it, but it's wrong to assume that that's the only conversation in town between Crown and between iwi.
Prime Minister Christopher Luxon joining us from Wellington this morning. All the best for next week at Waitangi.
Thanks, Anna.